Thanks, Rebecca.
Sure.
Hey, Rebecca K. What did you hear?
Well, I heard sounds, right? I heard sounds. And I know the sounds are music. Maybe not everyone would know that. I don't know. It sounds from the Western tradition, Western classical tradition. As a violin player, as a child through high school. So I always secretly wanted to play the cello. So I kind of hear my high school self listening. My best friend played the cello. I've always been fascinated by the cello. So I hear deep chords. I hear deep, deep, dark chords. I hear individual high notes, you know, almost higher than you would imagine a cello could reach. I hear a lot of rehearsals by Rebecca M. Rebecca Merblum's rehearsals, her years of, I hear that somehow in it. And I hear probably hundreds of years of rehearsals of that piece. I don't know how old it is, but I suspect it's hundreds of years old. So I hear the composer figuring that out. And he's probably a man. And the performers back then were maybe all men, white men, I'm guessing. I hear maybe a cello maker making that cello, testing the way the wood. As a sculptor, the sculptor in me is like, oh yeah, how would you make that sound? How does sound come out of a wooden box, essentially, with strings on it? We were always told they were catgut, which terrified me. And then the bow is horsehair, which was also very strange. I wondered, I hoped the horse's tails could just lose a few hairs. So I'm hearing that sound of and the texture, it's almost like I can hear that sound and texture, because of course my sounds made from my high school orchestra had a lot of squeaking and kind of, you know, not necessarily such beautiful sound, such deep resonant sound. And actually, so now I hear Rebecca playing it and I've got to know Rebecca. So it's very different than just hearing a cellist play a cello, like a cello playing, right? It's Rebecca. My friend Rebecca's playing it. So that makes it feel very special. I could kind of feel her self in that, like the vibration of the instrument, maybe even in her body and the sounds. So those are some of the things I heard. And it was beautiful, right? It was lush and it was beautiful. And one thing I really love about music that, like I say to my students, should we listen to music with words or not words, right? And so something I love about classical music, chamber music, there aren't any words. I love things that aren't translatable, that don't go right to words. And so that's really important to me. I actually don't listen to a lot of music, but when I do, I often pick jazz or class, you know, things that don't have words. My students actually seem to prefer words. So, well, Lesley, what did you hear? Did that sound go to someplace in you, or did it bring you to a landscape? What did you hear, Lesley?
You know, I'm a synesthetic person, right? For whom sound is truly deeply a visual experience, which is not always a pleasant experience to be sort of surrounded by the visual of sound. Mm-hmm. I'm a museum professional, and I can tell you that when I walk into museums, I can see the oil paintings up on the wall, but I'm also navigating the sound of the buzzing lights. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, two words that jump out to me in what you just said that really tied into the visual experience of Rebecca M's piece were the word Western and horses. Can't answer why, but I can tell you that the landscape was, it was a barbed wire, and not a threatening barbed wire, but a long running barbed wire that ran along a grassy plain, and it was almost a canvas of a grassy plain. And then there were these pieces where you would hit these notes and you would sort of, I could sort of see the bow strokes, but rather than being bow strokes, they were like someone that was like actually ripping long lines in the canvas of this landscape. And there was rain. So there was pieces where actually I could sort of feel a single raindrop as a note being played. And so when you talk about the horse's hair, there was a smell of the wetness when the rain first hits the dry plains. Mm. What's taboo?
There were colors, right? There were colors for you. There was texture for you. There was a landscape that arrived. Was there, how did you hear the sounds as far as sounds? Like, you played violin as well, didn't you, Lesley? How did that strike you? Did you go to memory too?
There were moments when I could actually, it was like I was inhabiting the bow itself. I mean, I was living in the stretchy, rosiny sort of roughness of the experience of the bow as it hit the metal. What are they called, Rebecca M? Strings. So I was living in that texture, really, more than I was living in the experience of the notes. And like you, I did play Suzuki violin as a child, but I really am not a musical person, I would say, although Rebecca M would disagree with me. But I'm so curious because, you know, we translate things that we hear, whether they're sounds or they're music, and we translate them through our bodies, and we translate them into narrative, like Motapu will do, into gestures, into spaces, into other senses, like myself as a synesthetic person. And this is like the play, right? This is the abundance of the experience. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, for anyone who's listening along with us, riding this Western train with us, I'd like to pose a couple of questions to you. And you're welcome to type them, any answers into the chat, or just sort of, you know, hold them in your mouth, hold them in your body. What did you hear, people here with us? And where did you hear? Was it like a sensation deeper in your body as the sort of lower registers of the notes were hitting higher in your body with the higher registers of the notes? Did your earlobes tingle? Mm-hmm. Was it like walking through sand, or was it like holding dirt in your hands or feeling dust on your cheeks? Or maybe for you, there were colors. Was this a earth tones or a primary colors piece? Or emotional? Where did you go emotionally? Was it hot sorrow or chilling elation, or maybe hot elation and chilling sorrow? What was the voice of the piece? Was it an old person's voice? Was it a young person's voice? And if you have any of these thoughts, you can type them into the chat, or how was it for you all to experience this piece? You come onto the Zoom and suddenly there's music. So just hold those questions and be really aware of how you listen, even to our voices or the way that this conversation is, or even the physical space that you're sitting in as you are experiencing this, as Rebecca plays more, Mutabu speaks.
And that's a good time to turn it over to Mutabu for his response to what do you hear?
What do you hear?
I'm a poet. I hear in word sounds. I hear in poetry. And I heard this. It's called Afraid of the Dark. Afraid of the dark. They proclaimed we were not human, broke us in as slaves, turned us into Black Sambo, Mammy, Zip Coon, Aunt Jemima, Uncle Ben, Jim Crow, Tanisha Anderson, Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Melissa Williams, Timothy Russell, Eric Garner, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, niggas, turned us into those people. Afraid of the dark. What is really happening when police white man handcuffs 5-year-old little Black schoolgirl? What did another officer think he was seeing when he forced 8 months pregnant Black woman onto the ground to arrest her? Afraid of the dark. They turned people into that dreaded criminal element to be feared. The menace they see reflected in the haunting eyes, staring Black at them, piercing into their own tormented souls. Hey, Billy, we are still strange fruit. But this melody is now older than old. Afraid of the dark. And so the music, for me, it just speaks. I hear it in terms of rumination and the sounds were brooding to me, but soothing at the same time. And so in my poetry, I try to capture real life things and tell stories that bring people inside of this experience that we call the Black experience.
Thank you so much, Mutabu, for sharing that. That's actually a perfect segue into why this came to be. Because everything about being inside sound and inside connection through sound was what I was hoping to create in the course of this conversation with Lesley and Rebecca. What is it like to invite someone inside a language that is very often considered in need of translation? But what if we were to look at it from different angles, make it more personal, and realize the universality in all of it, and return a little bit to the instinct of the five-year-old me that asked my mother to play the cello just because it sounded beautiful. And take us away from some of the intellectualizing of sound and put us in the body, put us in the deeper understanding, in the gesture, in the shape, and in the process that most of us don't get any window inside of if we go to a concert, for example. So normally I get to share with colleagues and we share the language that we're walking on stage with, but I found that that wasn't quite enough, that I feel like music is needed on a deeper level societally and metaphorically, that in the process of listening, in the process of coming together through this instrument, that I was able to be the most me. And by being the most me, I could allow someone to explore the most of them through the ear. And I started the cello when I was 5. I'm going on 44, so it's been a while. And I still love it, perhaps more deeply than I did beginning. I play with the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra and have primarily been a chamber musician for the duration of my career, which means no conductor and intimacy. And I've been craving that in any number of forums with people who move me artistically. So the museum felt like a wonderful place to explore all of these things. Also, I love the idea of changing what we think going into a concert. What is a concert? What if it weren't just going in a large space with a whole bunch of people? What if it was more personal? What if we got to ask more questions? And what if we got to really unpack things? And in the course of these conversations, I really feel like we've been able to find that sort of intangible third language, what that happens in the merging of two communicators. So I have just felt incredible value and connection through the course of this year, via Zoom, of all things. We haven't even shared a space in which the vibration can be felt in a tangible way, and it's still been that moving. I can't imagine what it would have felt like if we'd been able to be together. I want to turn it over to my colleagues to see what it's been like for them in terms of the reflection of the last year of conversations. So Rebecca, what has it been like for you?
Well, I signed up for it. I signed up for Cello Conversations, which I think was supposed to be in person, Rebecca. Then we had to switch to Zoom, right? Because I work at the university. I'm a professor of landscape architecture. So my building is just down the street from the Weisman, and I've been involved with many things at the Weisman because it's a fantastic place for all these explorations and strange things. And I signed up because, well, I love the cello. The Weisman is fun. And I love to explore the unknown. I always like to sign up for something that I can't imagine what'll happen. That's like a real draw for me. So then it moved to Zoom. And so that was strange. So I've gotten to know Rebecca only on Zoom. And then I got to meet Lesley on Zoom. And so I had no expectations, really. I just wanted to explore the unknown. And I do remember saying to Rebecca that, oh my God, if people could meet the musicians, you know, I mean, it's like if you go to a concert, typically you would be wearing a black dress and, you know, you efface yourself for the instruments themselves to come forward and the sound. So everybody's in black, they're in the background. And here was like, we were having this conversation about what is that like? What does it feel like to walk out on stage? Can you see the audience? How do you make contact with your colleagues, especially in chamber orchestra, where it's just this small group? And is it like telepathic or without a conductor, you know? So, I mean, I've been fascinated, and I felt like everybody would want to go to these concerts if they could like meet the people, like bring the people forward, I thought was fascinating. And then I got to meet Lesley, and I'm like, I have no idea how she hears like that. I was like, this is a revelation between Rebecca's music and Lesley's hearing, you know, because these folks, these Rebecca and Lesley's, their senses are really intertwined in very beautiful and unusual ways. So I thought, I had no idea people could hear like that. So I actually really learned a lot. And of course, then you learn a little bit more about how you hear. And just the importance of listening. I don't think we do much of staying quiet, listening. Listening to all sounds around us. I think that's a really beautiful, beautiful experience. And so I'll turn it over to Lesley in a minute. But one thing I loved was Rebecca would send me like these little sound clips, and I'd be like, oh, and I'd play it really loud. And my husband would be like, is that your cello player again? I'm like, yes, yeah, sent just to me. And so it was like, Lee feels like he maybe knows you a little bit too. So can't wait to meet in person, you two. So Lesley, what was it like for you?
So we got an email, probably from you, Boris, or maybe just from the Weisman, inviting us as the public who happened to be on a email list to participate in this cello conversations. And right away, I just responded. I'm not a brave person. I'm not necessarily a person for whom doing something that doesn't have a sort of known outcome is comfortable. But I immediately pictured that I was going to be sitting on the bridge over the Mississippi River with a person in a cello. It was like, oh, I need to do this because I'm going to be sitting on a bridge with a cello. And then, of course, that did not happen, right? Like Rebecca said, we went right into pandemia and the world of Zoom. But instead, what happened was this, like, it ended up being this sort of constant, I'll just say permission. So Rebecca M. talked about this third language when one person and another person start to talk about the way that they perceive. They have to sort of invent new language. Words, metaphors start to sort of wind together. And the permission that Rebecca M. gave me was to actually very honestly, very earthly answer the question, what do you hear? How do you hear? Because, you know, in this Zoom call, I'm saying, oh, I have synesthesia. I'm a synesthetic person, but really that's not something that I have allowed myself to even acknowledge. It's just been, I live in a world that is bombarded by sound, and I literally, it's like a forest that I wade through at all times. And most of the time, like I said, it's not a comfortable experience for me. But in giving language to it and in sort of playing with the metaphors of it. So for example, Rebecca M. was talking about, she said, she gave me a metaphor, but for her, it wasn't a metaphor. She talked about sometimes when you start a piece, you play the first note as if it had already been playing, as if the note in the air was playing. And that just, that way of thinking through music was something that I had never done. We did this play where I had just gone on a hike with my three-year-old, and he is really into shadows. And as we were hiking, he would hop behind me and he would become one with my shadow. And then he would pop back out. And then as we would move, there would be a large tree and I would hop behind the tree's shadow and he would hop behind my shadow and we would take turns popping out. And after that hike, it was really on my mind. And Rebecca and I talked about it and I said, can you play me a piece that is the movement of shadows coming in and out of one another? And so our conversations really were like this, where they were sort of these experiential, these sort of moments of living in life where I would put words to them. And then I would ask Rebecca to put music to them. And then she in turn would play a piece and then I would talk about it. So yeah, we sort of made this third language together. But again, she also gave me permission to now be my full self.
I want to interject in listening to the conversation about cello conversations, Boris, what was the motivation for initiating that kind of program, for reaching out to Rebecca to have her do this?
So ancient history about a year and 3 months-ish back, museum is closing, and we, Rebecca and myself, we were in the middle of planning Rebecca's residency in the museum. And the residency was supposed to take shape of about 20-minute long conversations between Rebecca and people who would sign up in the museum space, in between artworks, in different places in the museum. And we were thinking about what this conversation would be like. And then obviously we never got to do this. And it was a very transformational time for a museum. My joke that I repeat a lot this year is that it's extremely difficult and stressful to run a closed museum. And we were just thinking, okay, what are we doing now? What is a residency in the museum that doesn't open? What is a collaboration when you cannot meet other people in person? And well, we got to know Zoom and we started to use Zoom, and it was just like a default decision. Okay, let's try doing it in Zoom. Little I knew that it's going to last for a year and that it's going to develop to something so rich and deep as what we're witnessing and discussing now. So it actually grew from this practical problem of what to do with a closed museum to a really deep human connection through music, which I'm very much jealous of you guys, the two Rebeccas and Lesley, that you've had it.
But it's also a human connection. I mean, we're in the second decade of the 21st century. And so we're making a human connection through and with this technology. I told my students that if it were not for the technology, they would have had to put their education on hold for the last year and a half. And so we've made do. And I mean, it allows us to communicate. We can still see each other. There were a couple of questions that I've responded to from attendees that I want to share. Someone asked in reference to Rebecca's music and my poem, the question was, would you hear the poem in every bit of music you listen to? And my response was, I responded to the music, and then the mood I might be in would also influence how I hear the music. I met Rebecca some years ago. I performed with the Cavani String Quartet. And when I first met the quartet, I was not familiar with chamber music at all. I've done poetry with jazz and gospel and Caribbean music, soca music from Trinidad, reggae music, African music. And so the idea of working with a quartet was fascinating to me because it would allow me to hear myself with strings. But what I did was I just asked them to play their music, and I spread my poetry out on the floor and I simply responded to what they played. And it was amazing to me and how easy it was to feel the music, to be inside the music, how fascinating it was to watch the quartet communicate with each other through the music, literally taking it off of the page and putting it out there in time and space. And then my ability to place words in that flow. And so I just listened to what Rebecca was doing, and you know, that poem just came to mind. Another person said that they were taken back to a time, a time space in their life when they were first introduced to these kinds of sounds. And that made me think about how important it is to expose young people to the arts and culture early. Okay, and to let them hear, to let them see, to let them feel, to let them move and act and emote from the inside out. Because it seems to me in a utilitarian society, we lose that as we get older, you know? And so when we hear the music, when we see people dance, when we respond, you know, it touches something in us, and it brings us out. And so, you know, how we hear is how we hear.
I could speak for days about why what you just said is so important. I couldn't be more of an advocate. It changes everything about the composition of someone's being. I've seen it, I've participated in it, and it's happened to me. And everything about music is relational between the abstract and the literal, between the world in which we live, the sounds that we're producing, the cellular body motions, the sound of rhythm, language, cultural context, politics, it's all in there. And the page is a little bit of a misnomer. It's a two-dimensional, you know, it's a piece of paper with ink on it. And, but it's not. It would be the same thing if we walked by a person and just said, you're a collection of cells. It's not an accurate description of what's really going on. That's a personal statement from a time, from a heart. And to unpack all of it while we digest our own craft is a life in the making. But it's all about sharing. The thing about music is it's collaborative by nature. It's not a solitary art. And everything about it is meant to be given and shared and reflected. And so when we walk on stage, it's one human body. If someone pulls left, we go. If someone pulls right, and it's recognized consistently and constantly, the ears recognize all of it. Certainly the body helps. One can communicate in any number of ways. But I wanted to say one thing about the first piece I played and then dive a little bit into some more playing. The first piece I played was actually written by an African-American man. His name is Adolphus Hailstruck. And it is a theme and variations based on the hymn of Draw the Sacred Circle Closer. So he used that theme and created a series of variations based on it for solo cello.
None of us knew, I'm sorry to interrupt you. I just wanted to tell that everyone, those of us who responded to it, we didn't know anything about what she was playing, the history of it or what the name was or anything. Sorry, Rebecca.
No, intentionally so. And just from the musician's standpoint, I now want to talk about how it is that we come to these choices of what we play. I chose that piece specifically because of the nature of the universality of it. That a folk tune, a hymn, something from a different tradition that can be linked to any number of traditions across the globe, brings us together. Everything in our conversations is circular. Everything that goes into playing an instrument is circular. There are no verticals. Everything from pulse to sound is in motion. And so it felt remarkably emblematic of this experience. Also, theme and variations, right? That we start with something simple and it evolves, but it's still recognizable that the theme is not lost, it's simply been varied. That changed truth is not untruth. So I think it speaks to something on a much deeper level in the context of the world in which we're living. The next piece that I'm going to play, I will give you a little bit of forethought in terms of what it is about, but on a very small level. I'm going to talk about this on the cellular level and let you listen freely, just as I would ask a student, to place yourself in time, in space, in color, in narrative, listening with the eyes, the ears, the heart, history, time, the toes, wherever you feel comfy. The ground is a really great listening source, just so you know. It produces a tremendous amount of vibration, and if we were in the same room, I would have you take your shoes off. That said, there is a cellular kernel that begins the next piece that I've chosen to play. It begins with one solitary note. That note evolves into three notes. Those notes evolve into what becomes the main motive for the piece, but they take on tremendously different paths. And yet, a little bit like the double helix, they remain integrated. So they might go up the octave, they might travel down the octave in different registers, in different times, but they're still always present, whether audible or not. So it's a little bit of a trust exercise. It's a little bit of follow the line, but I'd like you to listen as you listen. There is no right, there is no wrong. Everything is experiential. If you have time, Evelyn Glennie is a very well-known percussionist. She is deaf herself, and she talks about listening through every cell in the body, and I highly recommend it. It is what I want to ask you to do. Live inside this sound. Travel with me.
Thank you.
Wow. Can I read a poem in response to that?
Of course.
This is something my wife, this is very different. My wife asked me to write this for a friend of hers that she met in the dog park who became ill and ended up in hospice. It's called Kindred Spirits for Lynn Tucker Grant. Spirit beings pass through this world to be, to feel, to recognize each other when they meet at the dog park. It began with Luna, with Spot, with Velvet, dogs doing dog things. Amina, Miss Lynn, sitting, watching, walking Metro Park paths, words not necessary when caressing exquisite nature vibrations. Now the village gathers together. Sisters circle round one of their own. Woman, mother, daughter, spirit putting your days, your house in order. Homegoing time drawing near. Angels waiting at heaven's door. Miss Lynn and Amina on the one. Inside circle, inside square. Spirit connection deeper than blood. Fears no more.
I love that.
So that's what music does to me. It takes me places and I just go with the flow.
That's the idea.
How's everybody doing?
I'm meditating for a while already on your response to one of the questions in Q&A. When you just responded that this is how we respond to music. And what I'm meditating on is how important it is to remember that responding is not the same as illustrating or as explaining or as commenting. It's just responding. It's just doing what your body wants to do in response.
Say more about that, Boris.
Well, where it takes me is our response with art. A relationship with that, I should say. And the way we very often feel obliged to respond to art when we respond verbally, to respond to it with trying to translate it into something that can be explained with words, which very often takes the path of explanation or commentary or criticism or any of those things. And then it's not a response anymore. Response is this, response is dance, response is movement. It's really what your body wants to do in response.
And yet we have to find a way to communicate it, you know, and that's where the sharing is, right? That's the difficult secondary translation, right? There's the translation of what we experience into our bodies, and whether it becomes a visual or it becomes a poem or it becomes a movement or it becomes a story or a memory. And then we want to find a way to share it. And that's the sort of the secondary, coolest, beautiful thing. Like for me, when I was listening to this, it was Cy Twombly inside my body. Like if you can sort of imagine, if anyone's been to the Twombly Gallery in Houston, Texas, he has these pieces that literally take up almost a story wall that start with a little scratch and then rise up, and there are these colors and they're erasings and then it lifts. And all of that was happening inside my body. And so how to describe that, you know, that's the, you know, do you talk about the way that the sound of a bird wing as you feel that inside your, you know, inside the side of your chest when you hear that music, you know? And I think that's both when it becomes super boring, when we have to sort of like find some way to, and I think maybe that's what you were getting at, Boris, that like, that's the, like, you know, then we just sort of are explaining, you use better words than that, or, you know, can we give it sort of new weird, the weird language, the weird words? Can we turn to someone who's just heard the same concert next to us and say, like, well, I had, that was ants in my armpit. How about you? You know, like, and I feel like so much of this is like giving ourselves permission and each other permission to really, truly say what it was like.
May I say one thing too, is that in the landscape of being a musician, you play a lot of the same pieces. I really thrive on learning new repertoire, and I've developed a lot of relationships with new composers, and I cultivate that. So we get to live in the dialogue with the person in the creating process and really bring something into shape and sculpt it with the person that has decided this, you know, is the thing that I would like it to be, or this is, you know, programmatic, or this is just simply a piece of music. But the thing that I think you're talking about here is, for example, when we play a Mozart symphony for the 500th time, when we play 10 years in the same concerto. And I think something that we talk about all the time is how to reinvent, happily improvise, and see something anew with fresh eyes. This is what kids are amazing with, and what teaching, I think, helps musicians understand, which is we have to create something so alive that it does feel like the first time each and every time. And if all goes well, that translates to an audience in terms of the exchange that you receive. But it is a different dynamic when it's something known. So I think that's the maturation of imagination. The response is the child, right? But how to keep it alive and how to remain engaged in the translation, to me, is truly the artistic process.
You know, in the African American and the African music tradition, you never play the same thing the same way twice. Mm-hmm. Every time you play it, I mean, it's the same song, but you interpret it how you interpret it in the moment. And especially in jazz, because it is so improvising is at the center of it. You know, I once heard a musician, Wynton Marsalis, say that he could go to Milwaukee, show up in a bar at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning with musicians he never met, and you know, we're gonna play a blues in B flat. And they just come together and they do that. And he calls it a negotiation between the musicians. And when I worked with the Cavani String Quartet, I saw the same kind of negotiation and communication between individuals. And you know, we've been together 25 years and we do some of the same things, but we never ever do it the same way twice, you know? And for me, that's the beauty of it.
100%. And I think that's where having a body comes in too, because the music, the page, the notes may be the same, but the fact that I'm sitting here in Cape Cod with the traffic going by and the fog coming in and the fog horns going means that the music that I heard you do, Rebecca M, is inseparable from that experience. And it's that ever growing appreciation and awareness of that mixture of sound and the soundscape that we're inhabiting just by being humans in a world, whether it's a bar at 2 a.m. or whether it's sitting alone in front of our computers, but that we still are living in this space and letting that sort of, that awareness sort of merge with the music.
I think there's nothing more beautiful than hearing the evolution of recordings, for example, hearing someone record something in their 20s and then hearing them record the same music in their 60s. It's different music. It's a different human. And it should be. I mean, one of the most well-known examples would be Glenn Gould, for example, playing the Goldberg Variations. As a young man, it was endlessly fast and had this tremendous sort of urgency about it. And as an older person, it had lived. It had no rush, deep spaciousness. And you can always tell how old a student is depending on which one of the two recordings they're most drawn to. So the younger students tend to say, I adore the younger version, so much more alive, right? And there's a certain point in study in which someone makes that shift in developing a certain level of taste. That's very biased on my part, but saying they can hear the life in the second version. There are any number of examples of that, but I really value that, that whole process of how much feeding the system changes the process, how much I understand the world, my relationships, love, you know, how many galleries, how much poetry that is in my system impacts every piece that I perform. Yeah. Should we open some of this to the audience? How does everyone feel? Would it be time to invite some Q&A?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, Tabo, can I ask a question while the audience thinks about their questions?
Sure.
Do you ever respond live to music? By coming up with new poetry, new words.
Yes. I was in a band years ago, and that's how we started our shows. We would just jam, and I would freestyle just inside the music. I haven't done that in quite a while, but yeah, I prefer to work live with musicians. And the group that I work with now is called Vince Robinson and the Jazz Poets. Maybe they can bring us to Minnesota.
Hint?
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
But with me, you know, again, I mean, I respond to the music and to the musician. So what I can do with a gospel choir as opposed to a jazz ensemble or an African drum ensemble, you know, I will respond to each one of those situations in a different way. Some of the things I do with the Cavani Quartet, I've done with jazz musicians. And I mean, it requires an adjustment on my part because I'm so used to hearing how I do things with the quartet. And it's very, very different doing it with jazz musicians, even though I'm doing the same piece. And I'll improvise off of the page. And so I've done things where people have had my books and they're reading as I'm performing with musicians. And I'll do things with lines with the musicians that are not even in the book. And so they kind of have to put the book down and just listen to what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a very good segue into the question that was asked. So maybe we can all look at the question. Someone asked, I would love to hear more about the effect of improvisation on listening, both for artists working together and for the experience of the audience, both in the sense of performing without a premeditated plan and incorporating change into known material.
Wow.
I think that's ever present, to be honest. I can't envision or think of any concert that I've been part of that it hasn't been ever present. That can be anything from timing changes to someone deciding on a whim to shift the character or the sound of something. That can be playing new music that literally asks you to do things by chance. For example, if you're playing works by John Cage, very often on the page, or any 21st century composer, very often you'll have a notated segment that just says, freely meet colleagues in 15 seconds. You know, things like that. You might be given graphic notation that says, simply move up and down the instrument at will between these two pitches for this duration of time. It's completely different every single time. One that I found that often sticks with me is, he's a well-known new composer, his name is David Lang, and he decided in one of his compositions, rather than to tell the sort of apotheosis narrative of an entire life, he chose one moment in time, very sort of Virginia Woolf-ish, and he explored that one emotion and its unwavering nature for 50 minutes. So we basically played the same oscillating notes for 50 minutes. And yet, even within that, which one can conceive as being like minimal, the idea is transformative, that with the repetition, we become further and further away from the present and have a deeper objectivity for the larger picture that's going on, maybe see the emotion from various lenses. I actually found it to be remarkably improvisatory, because when you're living inside something that in such an intimate way for such a long period of time, it changed and moved consistently every single night of the performance. So I think that's an element that is difficult to articulate, because in every world, improvisation means something else. Improvisation can mean changing the notes. Improvisation can also be doing something completely unplanned and spontaneous. So, and also, I do think there's a really happy shift happening in the classical music world now, which is that a ton of people are writing their own cadenzas, writing their own music. I ask my students to write their own material all the time. And I think it's becoming much more part of the lexicon than it once was. Because remember, in the Baroque and classical eras, everyone was doing it. Every single player was improvising their own cadenzas. Nothing was notated in the part specifically because the assumption was made that players understood the grammar, players understood their role as improviser. So we came away from that in sort of the conservatory tradition, and thankfully some of that is being dismantled now.
This is making me think about Indonesian gamelan. And I'm curious, because I've been actually played Indonesian gamelan for a long time, and I don't even answer that. I didn't even think about my experience with music because of gamelan. But in the gamelan, there's so much improvisation, but there's also deep, deep listening to the drum that sets the pace, and then the bonong, which sets the next notes that you're gonna play. So you're both sort of living in whether we're gonna quicken up or slow down, or whether we're going to, you know, where's the path leading? Are any of you, or Rebecca M, are you familiar with this sort of cross or?
Tons. I actually teach a music history course to my students in Africa, and we spent all last Sunday on gamelan ensembles. and I love it. I love it. It's part of that tradition out of Indonesia, and I think it's reflective of the entire mode of music that came out of Indonesia. But there is something in the actual sound quality of gamelan ensembles. I mean, they're all through the States now, and MIT has a huge gamelan program, and I think most ethnomusicology programs study them quite intensively, to the point now where a lot of gamelan ensembles are actually playing Western music. You hear them playing like Debussy and things like that. For me, I'm much more drawn to it for its indigenous sound and not appropriating sort of piano literature to the gamelan, although there's nothing wrong with it at all. But yeah, I do think the simultaneity is always at play, meaning something inevitable, which is pulse, and something very morphable against it, which might be mode, temperament, character, etc. But gamelan in any of those traditions, which are not that dissimilar to certain traditions in India and through some of the islands through Asia, Korea, for example, comes to mind with pansori, that there are those modalities, some of which are fixed and others with which they operate in motion around those fixed entities. So yeah, I think it's very similar.
And what is an example, I mean, for the panelists or the people out there, if we were to take that as an example, a metaphor for other things, so the fixed, there's something, a pulse, and then there's some other things that are sort of movable. Does that make anyone think of anything else in life?
Cue the architecture metaphors. Or whatever, yeah. To me, I actually think a lot about water when you say things like that, the tides.
Yeah, I thought about rain. I learned recently there's rain drums, you know, and I kind of as a kid and as an adult too, I mean, that's what artists are. I think a lot of us were kid and adults. We get to have our cake and eat it too. So the sound that rain makes on different surfaces, right? So I would arrange different things and have it hit. And then I was like a little bit older, or maybe quite a bit older. Oh, you mean this is already invented? Well, that does make sense, but you thought you invented it yourself to have the rain hit different types of materials or close, like if it was from the gutter, how close could it be or how far? So yeah, that really interested me. And so if you think about architecture, landscape architecture, I've often wanted to make like a rain pavilion, like a building tea pavilion, you know, some kind of place that plays the rain in a certain way, which I think would be so beautiful. So, you know, maybe, who knows, maybe hopefully someday. So I'm sure there's other people out there who made sounds or found sounds, or now that we have iPhones too, I record sounds. I'm getting increasingly interested. And as I watch our interpreter, I am grateful that I can hear. I mean, that is like a true blessing to be able to hear. And it was interesting for me to watch Rebecca play the last piece, because as a visual person, you know, I'm listening, but I'm also like watching her. Like I noticed Lesley likes to close her eyes. Well, I like to watch Rebecca and I love seeing her. It's like passion and mastery. And I couldn't tell if she was looking at music, but I didn't think so, but she might've been, but I couldn't, you know, it was like, she was just, it was so beautiful to me to see it visually and to hear it. So I think when I can hear Rebecca live and in person, I'll definitely take my shoes off, right? anyway, I'm looking forward to that. And I kind of want to play your cello like a little bit, but that's an expensive, beautiful cello, but maybe I can do a little pizzicato on it.
Of course. There's actually an anecdote connected to Charles Ives, who was a composer in the beginning part of the 20th century. He was a student at Yale, and he became very much known as one of the most avant-garde composers of the early part of the 20th century. But he never officially called himself a musician. He was an insurance salesman in Connecticut. And there are all these gravelly recordings of him singing in bars and various things. And he had this incredible personality. But his father is the reason that he became so experimental, because in their church, he would set up a series of glasses filled to different heights with water. And he was the very first person in the United States to experiment with microtones. And it was just in this little tiny space. And what he would do is he would ask Charles, while a band was marching down the street, to play the organ and listen to something else simultaneously. And so Charles Ives' music became this constant merging of multiple voices, deeply polyphonic, some microtones, often a tune in the back while other things are happening in the foreground. And I think that's all speaks to that, that sort of textural element of sound, and the idea of really combining those layers.
Well, I grew up in Russia, and I don't know, you might know this fact that Russians have joke for every occasion in life. They do. They call them anecdotes, but it has different meaning in Russian. It's actually a joke. So a little story that's a joke. So the joke about improvisation is that there is this famous violin player leaving a performance, and there are journalists. And they surround the musician and ask him, "Hey, maestro, why don't you play something for us real quick?" And maestro says, "What do you mean? I need to prepare. Give me a few days." "No, just improvise something." "Oh, that's 2 weeks." So on this note, I would like to conclude, unless you guys have final remarks.
No, I just want to take a second to thank everyone. To thank you, Boris, for giving this some sea legs. To thank Rebecca and Lesley for going on this journey together. I really think of you both as dear friends, and I can't thank you enough. And for Matavu, for joining us. You've been a beautiful person in my life from afar, and to have you integrated into the present day is that much more beautiful. So, and thank you very much, B, and to the entire ASL community. I have a number of people in my family who are a member of your community, and I couldn't be more thrilled to know that they're being spoken to tonight. So,
and on that note, too, as a hearing person, I recognize the richness of not hearing as well as hearing, that the experience of this question, you know, what do you hear, and the experience of people who are deaf is as rich, richer, layered.
My wife and I, on our last visit to Ghana, we visited the school for the deaf in Cape Coast, and there was drumming going on. They couldn't hear it, but they could feel the vibrations. They could feel the music. And so I want to thank everyone for this opportunity. And this was an experience of having our cake and eating it too. Because my thing is, why have a cake if you can't eat it?
That's the next title of a program at the Weisman.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Rebecca and Lesley, for your last year of conversations, even though I'm jealous. Thank you, Matabu, for being with us at the last stretch of this project and for moderating this. Thank you, our ASL interpreters. And now I would like to do land acknowledgement, something we usually begin our events, but today we decided to begin with music. We conclude by acknowledging that the Weisman Art Museum is located on the traditional and contemporary land of the Dakota people. We aspire to honor and respect the indigenous peoples past, present, and future by incorporating indigenous knowledge in our work and establishing meaningful reciprocal relationships with the carriers of indigenous knowledge and with communities. I would also like to thank the voters of Minnesota for supporting the operational budget of our museum through funds from the Minnesota State's Art Board. Thank you to Wells Fargo Foundation also for supporting our operating budget. And thank you to the Target Foundation for funding the construction of the studio that I curate. And thank you to Cindy and Jay Illenfeld for the endowment that pays my salary. And I'm grateful to my colleagues at the Weisman Art Museum for supporting this program and supporting the program for creative collaboration that I lead. Thank you everyone so much, and good night.